As the world wakes up, the beauty and serenity of Ocracoke Island comes to life. Everything about this remote island in the Outer Banks is about small-town pride and history. From a shipwreck hundreds of years ago that left Spanish Mustangs stranded on the island, to the nearly 200-year-old lighthouse, which majestically sits on the island's edge, helping to guide boats into its harbor. To the families who have called this tiny swath of land in the Atlantic home for centuries now, keeping their traditions of boating, fishing, and
high tide on the south side, last night of waterfall, night moonshine, no fish.
Talking alive today.
Said, don't know, but I lost my cat in Barney's Gap. Where do you think I found it?
Yes, talking.
Said, Titch's hole, God bless me soul, but my brim was tore from around it.
Don't worry if you can't understand what he's saying. He says he expects that.
He looked, tell me what part of Australia are you from? I said, North Carolina.
Rex O'Neill is what is known as an Ocracoker.
You say you got to take the battery out of this?
His family has been on this island for hundreds of years.
You don't need the helmet for a golf cart.
Today, he runs a successful business to keep tourists on the go on the island.
She's pretty simple. Every fold and reverse right here.
You might catch a bit of his brogue as he gets his customers situated.
Make sure the keys are on and make sure you're in gear.
But not much. That coming and going of his brogue is something he learned later in life.
All right, take her away.
When tourism became popular on Ocracoke.
You know, to us, we didn't pay no attention to it. Didn't know anything different.
Everything pretty much, especially in the summertime, revolved around this creek growing up.
His friend and fellow Ocracoker Vince says the surge of tourists to their tiny island has uprooted their lives and their long traditions.
When you're around other people and, I guess you kind of straighten it up a little bit. Especially when you're doing business sometimes because they can't understand you, you know.
I'm an outsider, a dingbatter, as they would call me. So for much of our conversation, they straightened up. But there were moments when I got a real taste of just what these Ocrackers sound like when the tourists go home.
Well, they got a watch, and neither one could tell time. They met on the back road one day, and they said, the brother, what time it is? Bill Orange says, our kid stopper said, there it is. No one looked at it and said, yeah, damn if it ain't.
Neither one of them could tell Tom he had a watch.
Damn if it ain't, he said. Oh, gosh.
If 4 or 5 of us are talking together, they can't really understand us. But, you know, we can understand each other fine.
First time I got reported on a Coast Guard boat and I had to make a pipe. And everybody ran to the quarterdeck. They said, who in the world is this? They said, where are you from, son? He
said, oh, my God. Yeah, I
mean, so you kind of learn to pronunciate certain words where everybody could understand them, you know.
So just what is this dialect we're hearing?
And everybody said, you have to go to Ocracoke because they speak Elizabethan there, right?
Walt Wolfram is the expert on the Ocracoke brogue. He's been studying it for decades and has come to learn that it's been around for centuries.
They don't know which terms are local and which terms are not, except when outsiders come out and say, what did you say?
As settlers came to what is now the United States, those who settled in the remote barrier islands were far removed from others in our society. That means the dialects of England, Ireland, and Scotland stuck around with the folks who decided to make this little strip of land home. And it was easy enough to isolate and keep the language going. You see, you can't make it to Ocracoke without a boat. Today, thousands of people make the trek on the state's free ferry system. But for hundreds of years, the island was shut off from many visitors.
This is part of the Carolee Doing ghost ship that came ashore in 1921.
Chester Lynn knows about that history.
Two of my family members were part of Blackbeard's crew. That's 300 years.
Yes, that Blackbeard. He pirated around the island in the 1700s and ultimately met his death nearby.
We all had to learn how to mend holes in nets.
For Lynn, his family has been on Ocracoke for centuries, and today he helps to preserve artifacts of its past and share the stories of its people with anyone who wants to learn them.
The mail called over. They don't call the mail over anymore, but they used to mail, the mail boat used to come in. They met at the dock, and they'd hold the letter up and holler, Uncle Tommy, come get this, it's yours, you know, and over a group of people. And if somebody weren't there, somebody else carried it to him, you know. And I still refer to it that as it called over, you know.
There are a lot of examples of phrases like that that the islanders made up.
There was a couple things that Mama would use to mix with Coca-Cola, and if we would feel quamished or whatever, and if anything, that would quamish us because it was something that was bad we had to eat, you know.
But he says he knows it's important to do interviews like this one because that unique dialect is fading away.
A few of us, when we're gone, it will die, you know. And the thing that I am really happy about is I am happy that I have been a little bit a part in its heritage and its knowledge of, you know, of keeping it as long as we could.
Lynn revels in Ocracoke's history, sharing his family's story, which he says is the story of many of the original islanders.
So there's only around 325 of the original families. Now, we're all kin. It don't matter whose name it is. After 300 years, everybody in that 325 is kin to everybody.
We developed a dialect curriculum that we've taught now for 29 years.
Wolfram has literally written the book on the Ocracoke dialect. In fact, he's written two.
It's a dialect that retains old things. It changes over time. Mm. You know, their term for hide and seek is me honky. Well, how did they get the term me honky? They got it because when you play hide and seek, you always sort of let people know where you are approximately. And they used to imitate the sound of a goat. Me honky, me honky.
He says the modernization of the island and the influx of tourism is endangering the dialect. But he says for many, the fear is much more deep-rooted.
The dialect is changing. The ecology of Ocracoke is changing. And so it's an island in danger of evaporating.
Wolfram himself is a dingbatter, but the locals treat him as one of their own. Still sharing their stories, even sometimes through song, and making sure their stories are honored. While modern life means some of these memories are fading, they say they will continue to share them in their own unique brogue as long as they can.